we are joined by Rick Grinnell, our senior advisor for foreign policy and national security. Rick, I want to go right off the top here. So we got Russia. We have a Russian official saying, quote, the Americans must assume that a number of signals from Moscow will be uncomfortable for them, including in the coming days. This is in light of the June 16th summit between Biden and Putin in Geneva. Here's my question, Rick, right off the bat, which is, you know, I get complications with China because of the economic ties, because of our own manufacturing, unfortunately, inefficiencies and things that we need to build up in America that make it harder to cut off immediately. Not that we shouldn't be tough on the Chinese. But the Russians, we're approving pipelines for Russia. We're canceling our own pipelines here. We're canceling Alaska drilling. They're beefing up their military in the West. This is a pretty serious show of something from Russia leading up to this meeting. And it seems like the U.S. just keeps shrugging our shoulders. Ransoms get paid. And, you know, first it was our pipeline, then it's meat.
And we've got our recruiting videos, which are clearly permeated with woke culture and language and not looking for the best and the brightest. And I think that's a big problem. Look, I think that what the Russians are signaling is exactly what Russian Foreign Minister Sergei Lavrov has publicly said, which is exactly what the Chinese told us in Alaska, which is that America is a racist, sexist, homophobic place. They get these talking points from the Democrats who have spent the last 4 years telling Americans that our entire system supports racism and sexism. And so we can't be surprised when countries like Russia and China are going to leverage those talking points while negotiating with us to try to get the upper hand.
You know, of course, it's so the duplicity in this is historic in scope. I mean, the Russians and the Chinese government criticizing the United States on human rights abuse or discrimination is really absurd when you think about it. I mean, recognize what Putin has previously said about these very issues. Oh, we don't have that in our country. And China, of course, denies everything. But there's a fundamental thing going on here, Rick, and that is this idea that we've got U.S. companies now are paying for basically ransom is becoming now the cost of doing business.
Look, I learned in my 8 years at the UN that Russia and China do not respond to moral arguments. When we create arguments to say, you know, do the right thing, or the international community is asking you to do the right thing, or just, you know, don't be racist, sexist, or homophobic. These are all moral arguments that work in the United States, but in Russia and China, they don't have a moral compass. They don't care about these arguments. They're looking for business deals and money and leverage. And so we have to be smarter when dealing with countries like Russia and China and some other countries that are not moralistic in nature. And we have to make the best arguments. So when our companies are trying to do business with these entities, they have to be shrewd and they have to understand what works and what doesn't. Moral arguments do not work.
Yeah, you know, Rick, this is a question I have because the reporting gets very different. You know, when it's China, everyone gets the nod that there's nothing really in China that's going on. It's not Chinese government control. They have a hand in every company, every corporation. And that's kind of accepted. In Russia, it's all being blamed on, you know, these criminal elements. But, you know, I'm thinking this is a strongman government. If they wanted to clamp down on these criminal elements, they could. They don't have to allow this to go on. So is it similar? I mean, when you were dealing with it at the UN, is this a similar type relationship with China just on a smaller scale that these entities are getting the nod, they're getting the okay to move forward with these attacks on a superpower like the United States?
I think they're different in that the Chinese are very ideologically driven. I mean, take, for instance, now they are telling families in China that you can possibly have 3 children, not just 2 anymore. So they're controlling the number of babies that are born. But a country like Russia is just really, it's all about Putin and money and the oligarchs. It's a corrupt regime. It's not as ideological as you think. Their ideology is, how do we make the elites more money?
You know, Benjamin Disraeli famously said that when you're dealing, and he was talking about Russia actually in the 1860s, that they understand one thing, and that's power. And you could have power doesn't necessarily mean war, he said. Power can be, you can be, diplomacy can be power. But he had this phrase of diplomacy is war. I mean, there's it's a kind of a war element to diplomacy. But they understand power. What are we signaling right now with letting all of this just fester like it is?
Well, I that's such a great point, Jay, because also I would take it to one step further. Therefore, if they understand power, they don't have a consistent moral compass where hypocrisy or pointing out hypocrisy or hypocritical policies is something that's going to work. They can't be embarrassed because it's all about the power and the money. And so I think what we have to do when we send in negotiators, which we are now going to be in a negotiation with Russia, we have to understand what moves them. What do they maximize? And we are going to be at a deficit if we try to make some sort of arguments of do the right thing and behave like an international player. And that's just where we've flawed in the past. We've done it through multiple administrations. I would say Donald Trump didn't do that. He negotiated from strength and from power and from trade and from money and from economic input.
I think you're right, Rick. And in many ways, you know, the Putin regime is a criminal organization. It really is. And I think about that. But what I'm wondering, other than things like the START Treaty, which I know you're very familiar with, what is it that we need from Russia that would cause the Biden administration to signal weakness and to sort of be super nice and bend over backwards with them? President Biden said yesterday that he has to believe that Russia, that Putin did not know about the hacking of JBS because in a civilized country, they would not allow that to happen. I don't think he really believes that. I think he's trying to convince the Russians that maybe he believes that, to try to entice them to act nice. But for the United States itself, geopolitically, what is it that we need from them that would cause us to really not be stronger, more firm with the Russians?
Ironically, what we need from the Russians is for them to act more moral, is to play by the rules and
not
to follow the rules. Yeah. And so that's where I think the rub is that we want them to act like a responsible international country and therefore follow the rules, whether it be international trade rules or UN rules, the rules of engagement in war, just to be honest and fair. But I think that we have to start from the premise that that's not what they maximize. And so we're going to have to put guardrails. And what I would argue is the exact line, the old Reagan line, which is trust but verify. Yeah. So we need to have transparency and guardrails so that we understand how to check them, because we can't trust them.
Yeah, I would take a call. Let's go to Dodger in Kansas on line one. Hey, Dodger, welcome to Secular. You are on the air.
First off, thank you very much for taking my call.
Sure.
My question is, so when it comes to the summit between the president of Russia and the president of the United States, I was wondering, what do you think the differences are between a Trump-Putin summit as opposed to a Biden Putin summit?
Power. I mean, I think that the lack of you saw the relation between Putin and Trump was one of mutual respect, because you had strong leaders on both sides. I don't like the way he leads, obviously, Vladimir Putin, but you can't say he doesn't exercise power and projects power. President Trump projected power with the Russians, so they weren't going to mess with us. That's how I take it, Rick.
Yeah, I think that's exactly right. And I would just state that it's a confidence thing. Right now, Putin is extremely confident that he can outmaneuver Biden. And this is an opportunity for the Biden team, is to come in. And when you're the underdog, when people are not suspecting that you're going to be tough, have a couple of ways to really put them in the corner and show that somehow what appears to be weakness is not weakness. That's the challenge for the Biden team. They know that Putin thinks that they're a pushover, and so they're going to have to counter that somehow, some way.